My name is Ben Pearson, the Roadster Tracker, and today I'd like to talk to you about the game Surviving Mars, and most specifically about how realistic it is. But first, let me just talk a little bit about the gameplay. I really like this game. This game lets you feel like you're building a real base on Mars and having to take care of the types of things that a person building a base on Mars will have to take care of, like making sure you have enough oxygen, making sure you have enough water, enough food, and all of the various things to get those parts constructed together. I think this game does a really good job at balancing gameplay and realism as a whole. I think it's pretty realistic. The game itself has about 10 hours of really good solid play per run, but once you hit that mark and you finish your mystery and you finish a decent-sized colony, there isn't a whole lot more to do. There are wonders, but they're really late game, and once you've built them, there's not a whole lot else to do, and they take so many resources that it can be even difficult to justify building them. Usually they're built as kind of a challenge just to finish off everything, and then that's it. But let me talk about some of the realism, and we'll start from the very early stages of the game. The first thing that lands on Mars is not humans, but it's robots. Robots go and construct a base for the humans to live in. It takes a couple of these missions to get everything perfectly set up straight so that the robots are all nice and happy. This is actually pretty realistic. Of the three major plans that I've seen to get humans to Mars, being the SpaceX, the Buzz Aldrin plan, and the Direct Mars plan, two of these three specifically call for robots to be on the surface first, the exception being the Robert Zubrin Direct Mars plan. But the other two, the Buzz Aldrin plan and the SpaceX plan, both rely on it, and the NASA plan isn't really formulated well enough to really make that kind of determination. Still, robots going and building at least the basic infrastructure makes all the sense in the world. They'll have the ability to refuel the rockets and do other things that are required. Sounds like a really great plan. Let's talk about refueling of rockets. The gameplay involves using water and presumably the air or the carbon dioxide in Martian atmosphere, using energy and turning it into rocket fuel. This is spot on realistic. All of the major plans to get to Mars that are relatively inexpensive rely on some form of in situ resource utilization, using what's already there on the surface of Mars to make it easier to get back home. And this seems like a very ideal way to go about doing it. So this seems really good. The main thing that the robots do, besides building the fuel supplies to return home, is building power. You need a fair bit of power, and the robots do that in the early game. What do they build? Well, they build solar power and they build wind power. Let's talk about the solar power first. Now, the only thing in game they use is metals. This doesn't seem very realistic. Really, solar power requires some fairly sophisticated electronics, and that doesn't really show up in the game. But there is another type of solar power. There's two main types of solar power. The first type is photovoltaics, which is what most people think of when you have a big giant solar panel that generates electricity directly from the sunlight hitting it. These work really good on Earth, primarily because they can be hit from any angle. If you have a cloudy day, like it is today, then even though you're not getting direct sunlight from the sun, you're still relatively bright and the photovoltaics will work really well. Even if you're pointing them to the sun, they'll still work pretty well. A concentrated solar array is another type. This takes and reflects all of the energy in the sun into one common point. It then will heat the whatever is in there, either water or perhaps some form of salt, and use that to run a turbine. Just like you would for coal heating the water to run a turbine or nuclear power or any other form of power that uses some kind of a mechanical turbine. This could very well potentially work. And it works better on Mars because Mars doesn't really have very many clouds. There are a few, but they're not seen very often. And the only real concern is when you have a big dust storm, the photovoltaics will work better than the concentrated solar array. But in game, when you have a dust storm, they all turn themselves down and don't function at all, which makes a fair bit of sense. So this is entirely plausible that they are just using metal, polishing it really well, and using some form of heated turbine to produce electricity. That's what my theory is, and I'm going to go with that. The wind power is more realistic than a lot of people realize. Now, the atmosphere on Mars is very thin. It's about 0.5% of the pressure that it is on Earth. But at 0.5% of pressure, it comes out to be about 1% of the density because the Mars atmosphere is denser. And that still isn't a lot. 1% of wind power from Earth is pretty small. But the wind is higher, it's 2 to 3 times higher. So if we go with 3 times higher, the energy in the wind is factored as the square of the power. So 3 cubed is 9. So we have 9 to 10% of the energy that you can generate through wind power as you do on Earth. Now, we see in surviving Mars, they have these kind of huge, ridiculous-looking solar power. They're actually probably not too far off. I'm not a super expert in wind power, but those wind turbines are set such that if the wind comes from any direction, it will spin them. And they're also very large collecting surfaces, so between the two of those things, I think they would actually work pretty well. There's even some talk of putting something very similar on chips. All in all, it seems like a pretty reasonable idea, and I think that it's pretty good. Now, they build things from resources that are found. One of the easiest things to build in-game is concrete. You put down a concrete extractor and it will dig up piles of the stuff. And you can put them down on specially resource areas that have a lot of it. I'm not sure if this will be required. Personally, I think that you will be able to find a lot of concrete on Mars, but you're going to find it in the way that the pouring company has worked it. They have high pressure that compresses the soil and dirt down so finely that it becomes really a brick. And this brick is very, very strong because of this high pressure environment that it was forged. It really becomes a rock for all intents and purposes. I think that's probably what they're going to do, although they probably will do something, and there should be some of the minerals that we find to make concrete like we do on Earth found on Mars. It'll probably work, and it's definitely going to be able to make a lot of use of the soil on Mars to build stuff. So I'll give that a mediocre grade, maybe a C on realism. The metal deposits are perfectly realistic. You're going to have areas of metal with particularly high concentration. The fact that they have the two different types of metals is reasonable. It's a game and you can't make things too complex, so I'll give them full credit for simplifying it in a way that still gives a little piece of realism. What about the more complex resources? Well, you have water. Now, water in the game, what you do is you put a water extractor near a spot where there's water, and they seem to dig up some soil and somehow convert that into water and then some waste soil. That makes a lot of sense, and that's actually how it'll probably be done. Real rocks contain a little bit of water. Any rock will. You take a handful of dirt and you heat it up, and you will actually have a little bit of water that will come out of it. It might not be so detectable, but if you weighed the dirt before and after heating it, you would see that there's a difference in the weight, and that's primarily due to water. Now, there are some areas on Mars that are going to have higher concentrations of water, and if you dig into one of those, heat the water up, then you're going to get the water extracted. You might have to do a little bit of filtering, but it should work pretty well, and then you'll have the super dry dirt that doesn't have any use, which is waste rock. It's exactly what you see in game, so spot on, I'll give them full credit for that. The machine parts are the next more complex thing that you build with time. Now, machine parts require humans, and we'll talk about the human habitation overall, but they're able to be used in a lot of the general manufacturing things, anywhere where you would need an engine or a turbine or gears or something like that. Now, of course, it's not realistic that one part would fit into anything, but I'll give them credit. There it is, a game. But these are going to be fairly easy to make on Mars, and you see them pretty early on in most games. Next thing, you have polymers. Polymers are made in-game of rocket fuel and water, and they could potentially use the air. They require the use of humans. Now, I don't know if that would be very realistic or not, needing the humans, but as far as using rocket fuel and water and air, spot on. The rocket fuel of choice for Mars is probably going to either be methane, ethylene, or propane. Why one of these three things? Well, they're relatively simple hydrocarbons, and thus they can be made with the atmosphere of Mars pretty easily. They're all pretty efficient, and they'll be easy. You can turn any one of these into plastics using the proper refining process, although it's easier to do with ethylene and propane than it is with methane. So it makes a lot of sense. You would use rocket fuel and convert it into plastics, which are polymers. And polymers are used in a wide, wide variety of things, and I give them full credit. You could probably make and do a lot of the stuff with polymers. It's relatively easy to change one type of plastic to another type, so that makes perfect sense there. Now, the third type is any kind of electronics. Most of the game Surviving Mars, it's easier to take the rare metals that you use to make electronics, send them back to Earth, and then have Earth send the electronics back, and you'll get a pretty high return on your investment. It's really only in the late game where you have a lot more humans than you have jobs for them that it really becomes efficient to manufacture these goods on Mars itself. That is also pretty realistic. Electronics are difficult. And Mars is going to be a pretty remote area. It really makes a lot of sense to manufacture thousands of electronics the exact same design. When you do that, then you get an economy of scale and it becomes cheap. But to just manufacture a few small bits of electronics in different forms doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. So it makes sense that these things would be shipped in from Earth and probably will be until Mars is relatively self-sufficient. So that's really good. Now, let's talk about the human factor itself on Surviving Mars. Humans live in some kind of a dome exclusively, including from the very first mission. That's somewhat realistic. Humans will live in something that probably looks something like a dome. A dome is a really good shape to get the maximum volume for a given amount of material, and it will also hold the pressure equally. If you had a square, then the edges of the cube itself will have a higher pressure than the face of it, and this unequal pressure can lead into some instabilities and thus holes. But you spherical shapes, such as a dome, will have relatively equal pressure in all directions, and thus makes a fair bit of sense. Now, you can build buildings anywhere in the dome, and it doesn't really matter. Of course, in real life, the center part of the dome, you'll be able to have the taller buildings. You have the spires that happen there, so it's kind of sort of like that, I guess. But you're not going to be able to build the same height of apartments on the edge of the dome as you will in the middle. And they're probably going to use the entire volume. Still, it's a game. I like the abstracted nature, and it works pretty well. The one nitpick that I have is the farms. You have farms that are built inside of the dome just like they were anything else, and in reality, you're probably going to build farms in a dome all by themselves. Why would you do that? Well, the optimal carbon dioxide level for plants is higher than it is for humans. For humans, 2-3%, and you start to feel some negative effects. Whereas plants will actually grow much, much better in that kind of environment. You're probably going to put the plants in an environment where it has a higher carbon dioxide than humans are comfortable with. The humans will be able to go in there, do their work, and still be okay, but they're not going to want to spend all of their time at those high levels of carbon dioxide. and thus you'll probably want to have them in their own specialized area. They will produce oxygen, which can be used for wherever else you might need it, but you probably want to have those separated. So the fungal domes actually do this, although the fungal domes will actually eat the oxygen, whereas these plants will actually produce oxygen. They convert the carbon dioxide that comes naturally from Mars into oxygen. That's how we breathe here on Earth, and presumably that will help, although not be all of the life support for Mars, at least initially. I do like that they stay away from the terraforming trope that you often see. To terraform Mars, it could be done, but it's going to take a long, long time. And with the relatively short lifespan of the colony that you have in that game, it's just not realistic. I did want to also talk about a couple of other things. First of all, you have the moxies that generate oxygen that the astronauts use to breathe. It makes full sense. This actually is pretty realistic. You have a lot of carbon dioxide on Mars. You could take this carbon dioxide, strip away one of the oxygens, combine it with another one, you have carbon monoxide, and you could just toss outside of your spacecraft, and there you have oxygen. It's a component of rocket fuel. It should be relatively easy to manufacture there. There are a couple of the wonders, too, that are pretty neat. You have the mole wonder, where you dig a big hole down to the mantle or even deeper, and this generates a lot of heat, and it also generates a lot of metal and rich metal as well, rare metals. This makes a lot of sense, and in fact, this would be a good way to get the heat needed to make Mars into a more habitable place. You'll probably have a number of these mole holes if we're really serious about terraforming Mars. It'll also release some extra gases that will help to make the planet a little bit thicker atmosphere and overall work pretty well. The other one I want to talk about is the space elevator. Now, the space elevator is this very tiny string that goes all the way up to space, about 100,000 kilometers, depending on exactly how big of a counterweight you have. It'll be attached to a small asteroid that'll be at that level, and if all goes well, it'll just kind of float around. It'll stay very stationary. Now, how well will it work on Mars? Well, first of all, they work best if you put them at the equator. There are some alternative schemes that you could have two of them that are balanced out at the same latitude, north and south, and it would stay stable. Although I think the early ones will be right at the equator. Why? Because the directly over point is a geosynchronous orbit, and it just works better. You could build an elevator on Mars easier than you could on Earth because Mars is a fair bit lighter. And that is pretty realistic. With today's technology, we could probably manufacture the string, although it would take an enormous amount of work. Now, where it gets difficult is Mars has two moons, Phobos and Deimos, that would be in the path of this space elevator line. And you'd have to arrange the string in such a way that they wouldn't be in the way and wouldn't cause any kind of damage. Could it be done? Probably, although I'm not an expert in this kind of technology, but it certainly would require a lot more work. Anyways, I want to hear from you guys what you think about surviving Mars, what you think the more realistic bits are and the less realistic bits are. And let's have a conversation. It's a really great game. I think this goes up there with Kerbal Space Program in terms of its ability to be realistic but still fun to play. And you can spend a lot of time doing some really neat stuff with it. I really think it's a great game, and I really enjoyed it thoroughly. Thank you very much, and let me know whatever comments you guys have or questions you have about space exploration. Until next time, keep on tracking. Take care.